Are we going to do the thing where we swap names like we were talking about, or you just want to do a normal show? I mean, we're talking about the Gmail thing. It's an acknowledgement of April Fool's Day, at least.
I've been thinking about this, and I'm not really sure. I mean, part of me really wants to go all in on this kind of stuff, but I don't think I have the stamina to actually do it. But
okay.
But I was
you'll hear my triple M later, and you'll see I've done something for April Fool's, so I'm perfectly fine to play this one straight.
Well, and I was thinking that once we wrap up the show, maybe we can like record a little tidbit of what's your guy's name?
Skip Grabobar.
Skip. All right, yeah. We might could do a little quick little thing where, you know, it's like you and Skip and Carl are in here, you know, about to take over the techSlant episode, and something like that I can put at the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know. We can see if we can work that in or something. I think I can do it in post and make it work, because it doesn't have to be anything real big. You know, it's just, you know.
And it hilariously works with where I'm disturbingly seem to be taking Skip, if the triple M was any indication.
So, okay.
It hit the one that I did as him. It was the very last one, and I'll go ahead and tilt my hand a little bit for you. I apparently went off to the bathroom or something, so he sneaks out of the box and tells everyone he hasn't fed me Twinkies in weeks. I've like, send him in a hashtag, free Skip. Wait.
There you go.
So it's almost like he's starting to become bitter and everything. It's a weird place to take him. But
yeah, slightly.
It just sort of organically happened. I was like, okay, I didn't write a script for this. I guess this is happening.
Sometimes that's the best stuff.
Yeah.
All right. Let's begin then, if you're ready.
I'm ready.
All right. In 3, 2, 1. All right. So, Sam, today is April 1st, 2016. Of course, we all know what that is. April Fool's.
The day you can't trust the internet.
I know. It's almost like you just need to completely get off the internet. Don't be there at all. And like I told our producer earlier, I do not like pranks. I'm not a big prankster when it comes, especially if I'm the butt end of the prank. Let's put it that way. And unfortunately, a lot of pranks can go wrong. And I'm kind of leading into something here. It's actually at the bottom of our show notes.
We can talk about it first, though.
Yeah, let's do that. Because, you know, the company that is probably the most infamous for doing April Fool's pranks on the internet is Google. But today, unfortunately,
they usually do a dang good job. This is one of those rare occasions where Google kind of screwed up a little bit. But normally they do pretty good at the April Fool's things.
Yeah, when this came up, I think I put this in chat earlier, and I said, you know, this is one of those things that they should have had at least a group of 10 people to vet this thing. So hopefully one of them could have raised their hand and said, guys, do you really think this is a good idea to do this? And of course, what we're talking about is this is dealing with Gmail. Now, a lot of things that I read today said that it didn't actually affect Google Apps. Like if you a lot of companies use Google Apps and their own branded version, if you will, of Gmail's email service for their company email. You know, adkissen.co, matter of fact, is a Google Apps domain. So it apparently only affected like standard Gmail users, and it wasn't even supposed to be enabled by default, based on some of the other reading that I did. But there's a button, and I've never paid attention to this button, but there's a button called Send and Archive, which I guess basically does, you know, it sends the email that you're sending, and it also archives a copy of it. Because, well, of course, you know, Gmail is like almost unlimited storage space for email. I mean, it keeps growing and growing and growing.
Right.
But what this particular Send and Archive button did this time is it appended a mic drop GIF of a Dominion a minion, you know, the minion guys. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, it turns out that, you know, not everybody was necessarily appreciative of the joke.
I don't remember if this was in the article or not. No, it wasn't. The worst one that I saw that was offending of this was that someone had given a condolence to someone about, I think it might have been an aunt passing away or something, and it put the mic drop at the beginning of it. So
if that's the one I saw, that was actually a mock-up in a tweet, but the guy was proving a point.
Yeah.
That's the type of thing that could happen. And according to some of the things in this article, there was actually some jobs lost over this thing. Not at Google, but
at Google.
Well, yeah, that's true too. But like this one person said, I just sent off an email with my resume to the first person who wanted to interview me in months. I clicked the wrong button and sent it with the mic drop. Well, I guess I'm not getting that job. Words cannot describe how pissed off I am right now. I'm actually shaking. One click, and I lost the job. And I'm not gonna say the G word, but because we try to be somewhat PG here. Not funny, Google. I'm gonna go cry now.
Yeah.
A professional writer claimed to have lost his current job thanks to the prank. Quote, I'm a writer and I had a deadline to meet. I sent my articles to my boss and never heard back from her. I inadvertently sent the email using the mic drop send button. There were corrections that needed to be made on my articles, and I never received her replies. My boss took offense to the mic drop animation and assumed that I didn't reply to her because I thought her input was petty, hence the mic drop. I just woke up to a very angry voicemail from her, which is how I found out about this, quote, hilarious prank. So I did see where Google came out and apologized and actually disabled this function, because my understanding is, from what I've read, it wasn't supposed to be on by default. It was supposed to be something that you could actually enable if you wanted to. So apparently, that was issue number one. Issue number two was that if you started an email using the Send Plus archive and you didn't send it, but it saved it as a draft, which is the way Gmail works. You know, you start to write an email, and after so long, it'll actually save it as a draft. If you don't finish it, you can go back and complete the email. Well, if you go back and use that draft to go ahead and craft another email, guess what? You're getting the mic drop. So, wow. The funny thing was, is I woke up this morning, and of course I knew nothing about this, but the very first thing at 7 o'clock this morning, my wife is scrolling through all of the tweets that Devin has reshared. You know, my son that, for transparency's sake, works at Twitch. Anyway.
Yeah.
And apparently he'd been retweeting some of the things that I've actually talked about here in connection with this hilarious prank from Gmail. And, you know, so right off the bat this morning, it's like, oh, my God, what is going on here? Oh. I mean, this is not the first misstep they've made in a prank, but good grief.
Right. There have been some other fantastic April Fool's things that have been going on today. Like, for instance, Tumblr right now is doing a fake election with, I think it's four different reptiles that were trying to elect as the head of Tumblr or something.
Is one of them named Donald Trump?
No, but one of them, some people have said, bizarrely looks like Donald Trump. I don't see it, but a lot of them have made that joke. So and they even got a professional guy to do a fake newscast about the different candidates and everything. So it was, there's some amusing. Some companies are very good at being pitch perfect with these things. Tumblr usually does a good job at it. And again, I'm a lurker, so I've never really told people what my Tumblr is because I lurk. I don't make anything on there. I just keep my put, I just keep my finger on the pulse of that part of the internet, and I get a bunch of lovely reaction gifts from it.
Yeah, Tumblr, the best place to find pornography, even though it you don't have to pay for it.
Yeah, but anyway. But yeah, it's there are different websites that do good things about April Fool's, and they do it because I think an April Fool's prank, in order for it to be proper, needs to not be invasive, I guess is the best way of putting this. And this, because of the way it was done, is invasive. I mean, like Time Hop, for instance, if you go on your Time Hop today, which is a service for those of you that don't know that actually archives your social media things so you can see what you were doing a year ago or 2 years ago or 4 years ago, you know, it goes back. Mm-hmm. But it is currently showing you things 26 years from now or things like that. So it's showing you the future. Like one of them is a cover of Justin Bieber's greatest hits with a very old aged up Justin Bieber, you know, and stuff like that.
He's going to last that long? Wow.
I know, right? I'm trying to pull it up here to give you a couple of the examples if it doesn't take too long. Like 26 years ago from now, impressed by President Kanye's socioeconomic knowledge and policies.
Oh, no. No.
My Beanie Babies are finally worth money again. Cha-ching.
Wow.
I did not expect Jaden Smith to EGOT so young. You know, it's... Or a poster of Fast and Furious 17 with a old man walking towards a car with a walker. So, or filed my taxes via Snapchat for the first time. What a rush!
Oh wow!
So yeah, it's they did a pretty good job over at Time Hop. So yeah, April Fool's jokes can be done well, but there has to be a level of not intrusive in it. And I think the thing that screwed up with this is that a lot of people robotically send an archive.
Yeah.
So because of that, they just fell into the prank because they didn't even really stop to think. Because even if it gave a notification of this is probably what's going to happen, I guarantee you most people are going to click an X and go, oh, that's a pop-up, click, and then keep on going like nothing's going on, right? Oh, yeah. So
I mean, you know, as seasoned as I am, if I get in a hurry, there are times when I just don't pay attention. Unfortunately. Mm-hmm. Now, I've never used the send and archive function in Gmail. I didn't even know what it was. So, I mean, that goes to show you right there. But then again, I don't actually use the web interface anymore. I actually use an email client to do all of my email and, you know, send stuff through through Gmail or Google Apps or what have you. So, it wouldn't have affected mm-hmm. me anyway. But, oh, well, you know, the question did come up, you know, is Google going to do anything to compensate these people that have lost their livelihood? And that's what happens when you don't actually turn your phone off.
Yeah.
So anyway, well, that's that. That's April Fool's. I mean, it was interesting to watch that happen during the day, and I really do feel bad for anybody that was bitten by this and didn't realize what was happening. So all right, some of these stories might be sound a little dated, and that's because they're over a week old, because we didn't have a show last week, but you know what, we still feel like they're worth talking about, especially yep. this one right here about you know, young people prefer an internet connection to basically anything else. Now,
go ahead and give the basics. If you don't get to the point that I'm going to make, I'll make it. So carry on.
Okay. All right. Well, the basics are this. This was a study that was actually done over in Britain. They did a study of 2,465 young people from the age of 18 to 25. And they asked them, essentially, you know, what are the things that are the most important to you? First choice was actually freedom of speech, which is interesting because, like they pointed out here, in Britain, it's actually far easier for rich people to sue people who say things they don't like than it is in the United States.
And right to be forgotten.
Yeah, yeah. Well, and And there's this whole thing about, you know, one of my distant relatives, Mr. Bean. well, you know, is Rowan Atkinson, so come on. but, you know, he's actually been a big proponent of trying to repeal those laws they have about, and I forget exactly what it is, but it really does fly in the face of free speech. If you say anything negative, you can actually be brought up on charges and put in jail. So that's kind of what they're talking about there. 69% found that would pick an internet connection as an essential thing, whereas only 64% choose daylight. And 57% selected hot water. Only 57. Hey, I need some hot water. No, I got internet, baby. I don't need hot water.
Now here's my question, because now we're going over these numbers. Here's my question. Did they ask them to come up with something off the top of their head, or did they hand them a list of things and say, pick one of these? Because depending on what this is, this goes completely, because I'm pretty sure it was off the top of their head instead of them having a list. And that's what kind of annoys me about this. Anytime that we get a poll was done or a study was done and this was the result, I become Paula Poundstone off of Wait, Wait, Don't Tell Me. I automatically sigh and go, oh, God, what is this about? Because most of the time, it almost feels like, and your methods were what? Okay, why are you even? It's not like you gave them a list of these things, and correct me if I'm wrong, right? It's not like you gave them a list of these things and go pick one of these, because I almost guarantee you that some of these people would have picked things like hot water and things like that over internet if you had actually given them a list. But in this case, it's what is awesome for you? Most of us are going to say internet, right? Because that's the thing that's probably right on our mind.
Especially for 18 to 25-year-olds, which, I mean, to be honest, 25-year-olds, that's not too far away from you. It's far
it's
away
one
from
year
me.
Under me.
Yeah, it's far enough away from me. But, and looking through the article, I can't find anything about the survey as far as did they actually present them with a list of questions, or did they just say, give us the top five things off the top of your head that you find essential. The interesting thing is who sponsored.
Yeah,
it's a company called Hillary's, which happens to make blinds.
Which immediately makes me put the tinfoil hat on, right? It's like, wait, so they didn't pick sunlight, and it's being sponsored by a blinds company?
I know, right?
Really?
It's like,
if I had some No Agenda sounds on my soundboard, I would play them, but I don't. So.
Yeah, they really like to impress upon in this narrative that, you know, these young people like to stay in dark rooms and play with their gadgets and make fake friends and have fake sex. And that daylight can be very, very jarring. Therefore, you probably need the best quality blinds that you can get to put in your room.
By the way, this whole fake friend BS, you could totally get me on an hour rant on that one. So I'm just going to say I disagree and carry on, keep going.
Well, yeah, I mean, there are friends and then there are true friends, even in social media. And I mean, that's right. Our group, we're true friends.
Exactly. And so, none of us I think you've met Oliver in person, right? But otherwise, none of us have met each other in person, but according to the people that usually go, oh, you're fake friends. You mean the people that you've never met in person? It's like, some of my closest friends have never been in the same room with me. Back off.
Yeah. I mean, well, you know, look at my kids. I mean, one of Tyler's closest friends is someone that lives in Kentucky, but he's never actually met her, though that probably may change sometime later this year because it looks like he may be going the PAX. But anyway, I kind of agree with you on the whole fake friends thing. Fake sex, well, you know, what is sex? You could get into an hour-long discussion on that.
It depends on what your definition of is, right?
That is correct. That is correct. So the article goes on and says, because of another result from the survey, from the writer's point of view, that made my heart pour grief, a fulsome 14% of these young respondents believe that the one change that would improve their lives would be having a bigger following on social media, because quite obviously daylight is what more Twitter followers will bring. So, yeah.
This guy does have a nice style. It was a guy, right, that wrote this, I think, right?
Yes, it was.
Okay, I thought so. I didn't want to shortchange it if it was a woman. But yeah, this guy does have a quite flashy style with his post. I did thoroughly enjoy reading this thing. Some things I disagreed with, but he does have quite a flowery language that even made me laugh my head off as I was going through it.
Yeah, it's a CNET article written by Chris Matz's... Well, he's Polish, apparently, and I don't mean that to be derogatory. It's just his last name is Matyszczyk. Maybe I need to call Walt and get him to pronounce it for me anyway. Hey, Wendrowski, can you pronounce this dude's last name? Since you are a half-assed left-handed Polak, anyway, he'd appreciate that. All right, this thing about the YouTube channel Troll Station, you put that one in there. I don't really know that much about it.
I don't know the specific channel, but let me give the basics here, and then there's a reason why I put, sometimes I will put things in our news, not necessarily to talk about the thing itself, but more something surrounding it,
sure.
If that makes sense,
sure.
Right? Mm-hmm. So anything that can make a good discussion topic. But in this case, there's a YouTube channel in the UK, I think. Yeah. But it's a YouTube channel called Troll Station. Oh, that sounds lovely, doesn't it?
Oh, I like it.
Troll Station. What could possibly be dickish about that?
Oh, it's not connected to Harry Potter? Okay.
Okay, yeah. Points. But has vowed to continue making films despite a team member being jailed for 9 months.
Wow.
No wonder they go by side names. Let me try to pronounce this properly. Dahan Van Lee, known as DigiDan, was a 15-year-old, God help us, a 15-year-old boy. DigiDan and a 15-year-old boy, whose name apparently was not put out there, were charged with making a bomb hoax with intent.
What?
Mm-hmm. Van Lee was given a 24-week sentence with an additional 12 weeks for threatening behavior during other pranks staged at two art galleries.
Wow, highfalutin, art galleries.
Totally. What are you, Edward Nygma? He admitted to both incidents and was also given a hundred pound fine, while his accomplice, who cannot be named, 15, was given a 12-month intense
referral order?
Referral order.
What is that?
I think he's on notice.
Oh, God. That's like pointing your finger and going, if you do that again, I'm going to tell you, don't do that again.
Yeah, exactly.
Stop or my mom will shoot.
Right, exactly. The pair had a suitcase containing a ticking clock, which they showed to members of the public before running off.
Wait. Did they make that clock?
Well, wait for it. Troll Station said it was making a tribute to U.S. schoolboy Ahmed Mohammed, who was arrested after taking a homemade clock into the classroom to show his teachers.
No! Okay. Oh, wow. That is, okay, sorry. I couldn't help that.
It was perfect timing. It really was. there's a quote in here, too. We were shocked that Don was charged with it, a spokesman told the BBC. Our aim was never to get away with breaking the law. I'm sure Don regrets ending up in prison, but he never meant for anything like this to happen.
Wait a minute. Wait. I'm sure he regrets ending up in prison. I'm pretty sure that's not what he started out his day wanting to. What kind of statement is that? I mean, I'm pretty sure he regrets running the the truck into the tree after he had six beers. But that's not really what he set out to do. I mean, God.
Here's another quote. Being arrested wasn't that much of a big deal when they, the police, found out that it wasn't serious and that there was no threat. The fact they wanted to pursue it surprised us.
Really?
Yeah.
Really? It surprises you that a bomb threat, even though it's not real? I mean, oh, God.
The team usually alerts police via the non-emergency number before stunts take place, he added, but he wasn't sure whether or not that had happened on the day of the bomb hoax.
How does that work? I mean, you call, let's see, what is it? Now, in England, it's like 999 or something like that for emergency. So, I mean, what do? They dial up 999 and say, hey, this is Troll Station on YouTube. We're going to be doing these bomb hoaxes at these galleries, so don't worry about it. I mean, if you were in public safety, would you accept that?
No, I wouldn't. Well, here's what the Metropolitan Police Federation had to say. We are at the moment facing very high risk in London of terrorism, said Ken Marsh, head of the Metropolitan Police Federation earlier this year. If my firearms officers are confronted with someone who they think has got a firearm and has discharged, if me and that person don't respond correctly, ultimately they could be shot.
Yes. Yes.
So this is the same basic principle. If you think some little have a bomb, then you're going to react appropriately, right?
Yeah. I mean, it's unfortunate not to really bring it to a very tragic event that's happened in the United States. But when you've got a child who is playing with a toy gun, which is supposed to have the orange cap in the end of it, but the cap's been removed, the police officer has no choice but to assume this child, who could be 8, 9, 10, whatever, has a deadly weapon, and they must protect themselves.
Mm-hmm. And here's the rest of the stuff their representative had to say. Light said they feel the police have made an example of them. Quote, they are sending out a message, he said. The station consists of 8 people in their early 20s. Big freaking surprise. self-hating millennial, I'll admit it. Quote, it's just a group of friends trying to get out of working 9-to-5 in retail, he added. The group is currently crowdfunding to go on tour. Okay.
Oh my
God. So here's the topic I wanted to bring up with this thing. I hate stations like this on YouTube. With a passion. All of these prank stations, which are usually run by 20-somethings around my age, that just, I want to take my hands, wrap them around their neck, and not choke them, but just hold them so they're in place and shake them a bit and go, what the heck are you thinking? Tell us how you really feel, Samuel, right?
Yeah, that's right. You know.
But no, there's this one channel, and I can't think of the name of it. It's an American channel, though. I mean, they were the guys that did the Mario Kart in real life and stuff like that, where a guy dressed up like Mario drove out in traffic and even tossed banana peels behind him and everything like he was playing Mario Kart.
Uh-huh.
And that channel specifically does video game things. Like, Jacob was showing me some of them, and I went, these guys are jerks. What the heck? And he said, yeah, they are. You know, some of them you could probably find cute. Like, the ones that don't bug anyone are cute. Like, they've done Assassin's Creed ones before where one of them is dressed up as one of the assassins, and they just go through the crowd, crouch on a little area, jump into a thing of hay or something like that. You know, stuff that doesn't hurt anyone. But most of the time, it's disturbing the public, doing just crap that doesn't need to be done. And the thing is, these people get millions of hits. Because their fellow 20-somethings find it hilarious. That's and I'm right. the one going, guys, no, it's not funny. What are you doing?
Well, you know, Philip DeFranco, a couple of weeks ago, actually, he didn't get in hot water, but he got a little bit of hate because he made the statement that the majority of the pranksters or the prank channels on YouTube, save for maybe three, mm-hmm. are all fake.
That probably.
They're not really, and the people have actually, because there's that one guy, I can't remember his name, he was accused of sexually assaulting women in one of his pranks, and it come out that no, that one was staged. And then when he came back mm-hmm. and actually did the one where he staged, like, this dude's best friend was about to get assassinated. Yeah, Sam Pepper. Thank you, producer. And then, of course, you know, the internet just went apeshit crazy over that one. It's like, how could you do this? And, of course, then it come out that was staged also. But even if they're staged, I don't find any of this stuff funny, honestly.
It's not comfortable to me. It really isn't.
Me either. Especially, now, these assholes over in London, with the, and not to make it political, but they are constantly facing terroristic threats, you know, bombings of trains and things like that. That's not something to prank. That's not something to make fun of.
I
feel that they got exactly what they deserve. They're not being made an example out of. Matter of fact, I think the sentences are too damn short. I mean, you want to be a young 20-something that doesn't want to work a 9-to-5 job? Guess what? We got a place for you, buddy boy.
You'll be making license plates.
Yeah, washing laundry. It won't be 9-to-5. It might be 7-to-7, but... Oh, yeah. I wish... And this isn't really fair either, but... You know, I almost want to make the statement that I wish YouTube would actually just ban prank channels, but that's not fair either, so... I don't like them. Don't like them at all.
Nope.
All right, so I saw the video of this next thing where I was talking about the system that instantly edits videos to make it look like you're saying something you're not. Article states, once upon a time, a photo of something was enough to believe it was real. Sure, you'd have to deal with the occasional Bigfoot hoax. What do you mean hoax? Bigfoot's real. But for the most part, those who had the time or talent to create believable fakes were in the minority. And of course, then came the age of Photoshop. Edits and fakes are prolific enough that fake has become the default. A dubious photo is presumed fake unless proven otherwise. Yeah, the whole... You know, pics or it didn't happen. Well, that doesn't even count anymore.
Yeah.
It says we're not quite to that point with video. Fake videos exist in droves, obviously, but editing a video to be something it's not introduces a bevy of challenges not found in the editing of a single still frame and generally requires considerable more time and talent to do right. People will still yell, fake, but it'll be a quieter yell. As your Facebook feed probably proves, moderately well-faked videos have a much easier time finding believers. I swear, Bigfoot is real. I've seen the video on Facebook. It was, you know, it's... and I watched that one right after I saw the aliens land. So I've been trying to tell people, but nobody will listen. All right,
guys,
so,
I'm telling you, Bigfoot is real. He is somewhere in San Andreas. You have to look in the game, but eventually you'll find him. Bigfoot is real.
I saw him down here in South Georgia. Matter of fact, I think he lives just a little bit away from me. His name's Producer. I mean, anyway. Oh, and he calls me Leo. All right. So you take a YouTube video of someone speaking, like they gave an example of George W. Bush. Really good example, because you can make that idiot say anything. Use a standard RGB webcam to capture a video of someone else emoting and saying something completely different. Throw both of the videos into the face-to-face system, and voila! You now got a relatively believable video of George W. Bush's face saying, "We shouldn't have gone to war in Iraq." But anyway, doing whatever the actor in the second video wanted the target's face to do. And like I said, I saw Philip talk about this on one of his shows last week or week before. It's not pixel perfect. Low-res clips were shown. They have this valley effect. Something's just not quite right. But, you know, at this level of technology, I mean, just getting started, it's pretty impressive. So, I don't know. What do you think about this? I mean, talk about pranks. I mean, you can do here.
Totally. Well, the first thing that came to mind on me before I give an absolute opinion of this is I've already thought about this in the past because, and I'm not going to spoil anything for anyone, but way before I ever saw this article, Andrew Main's book, Angel Killer, which features a FBI agent that used to be a magician. It's a fantastic book. Anyone should check it out. But Angel Killer actually dealt with this exact idea way before we ever got a example of it doing it, which this is something people have been working on for a while, right? I'm not saying Andrew Main invented this, but the first time that an idea like this came to mind, I was listening to Angel Killer and went, holy crap, that's an interesting idea. And now it shows up in an article for us to cover. So I'm just giving Andrew some props for bringing that to my attention first before anyone else has.
He was literally there with the developers. That's what it was.
Yeah, totally. Can you guys hold off a bit on this? That way I can put it in a chapter of my book. That way Jessica Blackwood can deal with this. Okay, thanks, guys.
Yeah, that's right.
I'm surprised you guys trust me because no one's supposed to trust me. But anyway.
That's right. Don't trust him.
it's interesting. I could see if we got the fidelity up more, sure, it could have its sinister uses. But it could also have interesting uses, like, for instance, I can't believe I'm going to have to describe his. Okay, in Hunger Games, the one head of the resistance, the actor ended up overdosing. And I still don't know how they actually dealt with it because I haven't seen the last movie yet.
Him. He was in Twister.
Yeah. It's funny you pulled Twister.
Seymour Hoffman.
Philip Seymour Hoffman. Yeah. There we go. But I could see something like that where if someone died or something like that, then you could fill in the rest of their scenes doing something like this. Or, you know, it's...
Well, yeah, it could yeah. Even, I mean, because think about it. They like they did for Paul in the Fast and Furious 7 movie, they brought his brothers in to actually help. So that would have even been better because they already resemble him to do something like this and then extrapolate that over their face.
Right.
Yeah, that would be great. I mean, I could totally see this as just upping the game when it comes to special effects in movies and even video games because we all know most video games now are mo-capped, so there's no telling what you could do.
Yeah, I mean, we've even got examples in the past of games that are the logical of that extreme. L.A. Noire comes to mind, that ill-fated, fantastic game. I love that game to pieces, and I know it's never going to happen again.
I never could finish it.
Studio. Oh, seriously?
Yeah, I never could finish it. I got to get back into it.
Oh, yes, you do. It's awesome.
I couldn't drive. I didn't realize until I think maybe you told me that I could actually say, hey, no, you drive. I don't want to drive.
Yeah, there are some points you have to drive for chases and stuff like that, but otherwise you can't.
I was terrible. I was on the sidewalk. I ran the red lights. I'd go into buildings. You know, women would be screaming left and right. Ah! And I'm like, where did this bra come from? And, you know, whoa, those aren't my panties. But, yeah.
You became Frank Drebin while you were driving, right?
Yeah. Oh, goodness. But, yeah, this is great technology. And what's weird is we didn't put it in here, but earlier this week there's an article because I think Microsoft had their Build conference this week. And, of course, they got, you know, they've got the HoloLens technology. Well, they're actually working on holograms, as in almost, not quite Star Trek level, but to the point where, you know, you can scan your body and it gets compressed and transmitted over to someone that you're having a conversation with. So you can actually be in a virtual reality environment and be standing there talking to one another.
I think the example that they gave that most people are going for is, God help us, we have to think about the Star Wars prequels for a second. So stop the nosebleeds, people, if you can. Shove some tissue up your nose so you don't totally get the pain from it. I played to the audience. But anyway.
Definitely.
The Senate scenes where they would be in the little the Council of Jedis, where there would be a hologram of Yoda over in that one chair and stuff. That's one person that tried out this idea likened it to that, to where you're just sitting in a room and there's seats there that are representing the people, but it's giving you a hologram where that person would be sitting.
Yeah.
Sort of. So it's one of those things where, yeah, it wouldn't be, oh my God, you're in the same room, but I can feel like I'm having a face-to-face conversation with you right now, at least. Right. So.
Yeah. Think about podcasters.
Oh yeah.
I mean, you know, we already do this stuff. Like we're in our various studios, but we could put this technology to use where we're actually sitting in a virtual round table and talking. I mean, that would, I mean, it'd almost be like that scene from the episode of Doctor Who, you know, when they do the, what do you call that? You know which one I'm talking about, the one where...
psychic conference.
Yeah, the psychic conference, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it'd be just like that. See? Doctor Who.
And it wasn't me. Just pointing that out, it wasn't me.
Yes, of course, the producer has to pull out. The chair was real, so was there a similar chair where Yoda was supposed to be?
Huh. Yeah. I always thought that, too, but anyway.
You have to wonder. All right. Well, let's hand it to those damn pesky 18 to 24-year-olds. But Microsoft... You know, and another thing that was brought up at the Build conference is bots. They have gone crazy.
They almost went Steve Ballmer, but instead of developers, yeah. It was bots.
Pretty much. So they had developed a chat bot, and it kind of went rogue on Twitter. It was experimental, and they what it did is it was learning conversations to interact with 18 to 24-year-olds, and within 24 hours, it became very racist, apparently loved Hitler, hated the Jews.
Which those two go hand in hand, let's be honest.
Yeah. it was... to say that egg was upon someone's face is a little redundant because, holy crap.
See, here's the thing. I don't know if I would call this a failure, and this is a really weird way of looking at it, but they were designing a bot that had machine learning built into it, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the reason that this failed, I'm putting in quotes, is because eventually these 18 to 24-year-olds figured out what was going on and started feeding it things. They sort of reverse engineered it and figured out, well, if I send it this a certain way, it will start learning this. So they started to reverse engineer it and start to tweak the system a little bit. I'm not sure I count that as a failure because it was it being handed things and then the thing being so convincing they had to shut it down because it became a Nazi, for lack of better terms. I'm not sure if that's a failure. It's just, yeah, they got pranked and everything, sure.
Well, that's true. It proved that it could be trained.
Exactly. It gave them information, which was part of the experiment in the first dang place, was could this be done?
Yeah.
It can be done. It can be messed up, but it can be done is the main.
Yeah. Microsoft said that in the bot's name was Tay, T-A-Y, is designed to engage and entertain people where they connect with each other online through casual and playful conversation. The more you chat with Tay, the smarter she gets, so the experience can be more personalized for you. So this is where the unfortunate consequences was Tay was being taught to tweet like a Nazi sympathizer, racist, and supporter of genocide. Those who attempted to engage in serious conversation with the chatbot also found limitations to the technology, pointing out that she didn't seem interested in popular music or television. Well, that's a typical millennial.
Oh my god, I'm a bot.
I was going to say, that's a typical millennial. So, anyway, they took her offline, even though it temporarily, accidentally, I believe, got reactivated Thursday when the build conference was happening, and, of course, then was quickly taken offline again, so... Oh, followers questioned why some of her tweets appeared to be being edited, prompted one to launch a hashtag Justice for Tay campaign, asking the software giant to let the AI learn for herself. Skynet, here we come.
Reminds me a bit of Her, if I'm thinking of things.
Yes, that was a very good movie.
Oh, yeah, it was. It was awesome.
I mean,
I would feel ripped off at the end. No spoilers, but I would feel ripped off at the end, but still.
Oh, I know. What was sad is I was falling in love with the AI, so, and I was watching the movie. I wasn't even in it, and I was falling in love. Of course, I knew who was voicing the AI, so I had that going in my head, so.
I was letting you use that joke against yourself instead of me.
Yeah. All right, so scientists push a record 57 gigabits per second through fiber optic lines. Woo-hoo! Yes. How about we just get fiber everywhere? That'd be great. So university...
Which means I'll get it in 20 years.
Yeah, I think it's slated for you in 2040. Yes. Okay.
Yeah.
And it won't be 57 gigabit. It'll be 1 gigabit, which 1 gigabit will be like, so 15 years ago... So,
right.
Don't ask me why I went that way. Anyway, so University of Illinois researchers reported that they've set a record for fiber data transmission, delivering 57 gigabits of error-free data, and they sent it at room temperature, because apparently that's been an issue. They've had to cool it to get these faster speeds. At this point, they even got it up to 185 degrees Fahrenheit, and it was still delivering at 50 gigabits per second.
Impressive.
So, of course, you know, the first people that are going to get this technology are backbone providers, because the data going from one data center to another and all of that, that'll be great. But, you know, we got 4K video coming up. I mean, Netflix is doing some 4K stuff. So we're all going to need more bandwidth for sure. So this is nice because... I think right now, and I've been out of the game a little bit, but I think right now 10 gigabit is what typically is the maximum on a lot of the big core switches. So, you know, 57 gigs, God, that's over five times the capacity of what they can currently do. So I like it. Why did that do that? Thank you. I got to love Google Sheets. I really do. No, I don't. All right. So let's see. This one is about how 11 lines of code broke the internet.
This is your department. I will be gladly listening to how this was possible.
All right. So... you got this guy in Oakland, California, who he's a coder, web developer, or whatever. His name is Azer Kukulu, and I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing that right.
I think you're close.
Yeah, close enough, I guess. He's big into open source, and so what happened was he had a project that he was publishing code to this company called NPM, which is, I guess, kind of like GitHub, which is like a depository where you put your projects and people can download it, they can work on it, they can push updates to it. If you like their updates, you can merge it and all this other kind of stuff. It's open source stuff. Now, MPM also has a commercial side of it, but it really doesn't have anything to do with this. Like they said, it's a popular service that's widely used to find and install open source software written in JavaScript. So it has become an essential tool in web development. And what happened here is a lot of your packages, especially in web development, you may not actually do anything that directly interacted with these 11 lines of code, but you may use a library in your programming of some function, some feature you have in your website, that library actually connected and used these 11 lines of code. All right, so he was contacted by a company because one of his open source projects was called Kik, K-I-K. And he was, let's see. All right, let me drill down here. Okay. One of the open source JavaScript packages that he had written was Kik, which helped programmers set up templates for their projects. It wasn't widely known, but it shared a name with Kik, with a capital K, the messaging app based in Ontario, Canada. So on March 11th, he received an email from Bob Stratton, a patent and trademark agent who does contract work for Kik. Stratton said that Kik was preparing to release its own package and asked if Kukula would rename his. He said, "Can we get you to rename your Kik package?" And Kukula wrote back, "Sorry, I'm building an open source project with that name." So the conversation escalated. Stratton threatened legal action. And he said, "You know, we don't mean to be a dick about it, but it's a registered trademark in most countries around the world. And if you actually release an open source project called Kik, our trademark lawyers are going to be banging on your door and taking down your accounts and stuff like that. We'd have no choice but to do all that because you have because you have to invoice trademarks or you lose them." And Kukula replied.
His reply is ironic, in my opinion, but go ahead.
Yeah. "Ha ha, you're actually being a dick, so F you, don't email me back." Oh, I guess that's the proverbial pot calling the kettle black kind of thing.
Totally.
Yeah. So Stratton even offered to pay for the name, and Kukula said, "Okay, $30,000. Apparently, that wasn't going to work for Kik. So they take their case, Stratton, the company Kik, take their case to MPM. They side with the company, hand the name over to Kik, the company, which then pissed off Kukula and said, "Fine, unpublish all of my stuff." So they did. Little did anybody know, the hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of websites, apparently, that somewhere in their code referenced one small little snippet, 11-line piece of code called left-pad, if I remember correctly, that was part of his repository. When it got unpublished, all of these websites started erroring out, including the package that Kik itself was working on. They couldn't even publish their own package. So once MPM figured out what was going on, they republished the 11 lines to get everything going again. But I guess it's more to the point. There's a couple of different issues in this story. Number one, trademark, of course, is one. And, you know, me and one of our other friends, we had a lively discussion about this. And you know, point well taken. Kukula was acting somewhat dickish. But I also saw it from his point of view that, look, he's someone who is really open source centric, he probably sees any communication from a corporation as a threat to open source. So he's going to take an adversarial position. He could have handled it a little better because ultimately he's going to lose. If they own the trademark, there's no way he can win this.
Right.
All right. So he did in a knee-jerk reaction, which a lot of us would do because we're pissed. All right, I'm mad at MPM because you did what I think is you're siding with the man, you know, so you can't be trusted. I'm not going to have all my stuff with you anymore. I want it taken down. So he did that. A little bit childish, but I can also understand it. But I guess the more significant point that is made here is how all of these technologies are so intertwined to the point where, you know, it's a used to in programming, you did everything yourself. You know, if you needed a library, you either wrote the library or you bought the library, or if it was an open source library, you grabbed the library, you integrated it into your package, and everything was done that way. Now, it's common and actually recommended that everybody interop and use everybody's stuff, if you will. The problem with that is when something goes down or is removed, and it winds up being what people would think of as an insignificant little piece of 11-line code, everything just falls apart. And that is a real big issue. It's a major hole in the way web technologies are used today. I don't think this is going to change anybody's attitude about it, but if nothing else, you better have a fallback position. But then again, like they said, you know, if I'm doing something with JavaScript and I'm incorporating a library, I don't know, I may not know that library is actually making a call out to NPM servers to get me this 11 lines of a module or a function called left dash pad, you know?
Right.
So I think there's people on both sides of the equation that are saying, you know, they're rooting for him. And then, of course, there are people that were like, well, the kick, the company was within the rights, which whether you like it or not, and I have to admit this, they were within their rights because of trademark. But like I said, the bigger issue comes down to, is it better to make sure that all of your stuff is local to you? Is that going to be a detriment because you may not get some of the feature sets that you could get otherwise? I mean, honestly, I don't know how to solve this problem because I'm not a big JavaScript programmer. I haven't really written anything in like 10 years, and even then it was in Visual Basic. I mean, Tyler's the programmer in the house. So I don't know. I mean, I know you're not a programmer, Sam, but what did you think about how all of this came about?
I'm going to show my ignorance. I suppose I'm looking at this from the human perspective of things. I'm not saying anyone's too much of a nerd or anything like that. That's not what I'm saying. But I suppose I can only look at this from the human side because I don't have the coding experience, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the human side of the story is, yeah, this guy was being a total jerk. I mean, okay. How hard is it to change the name of something? The amount of times that these startups changes their name on almost a daily basis to where you can turn it into a drinking game is almost laughable at this point, right?
Yeah.
So one bit of code, one package of code, how hard is it for you to just change your name?
Well,
they're not telling you to take your code down. They're not telling you to do anything other than change a freaking name. I don't get what his problem was. Even if we go with the argument of open source versus corporate, which is something I understand, even though I'm not a programmer. I love the idea of open source. It gives me a lot of awesome things to work with. I currently have a Hearthstone deck tracker, which is open source, that I probably wouldn't be able to use if not for the open source community. I get tools as a user that doesn't program to where I understand open source. But even if we go from the open source versus corporate thing, I still sit here and go, the way that all this unfolded leaves me, just as the person sitting on the outside, going, the programmer was a bit of a douche, and he kind of needed to just back off a little bit, think they're just wanting me to change the name. They're not trying to encroach on my rights to do my code or anything. They just want me to change a freaking name, and you should have changed the name.
I don't disagree with you on that. He could have named it KIKK or K or kicker or CAC or something. I mean, he could he definitely could have done that. And like I said, and even the discussion I was having with our mutual friend, I even told him later I was only taking that position against him because I use him as a training tool to help me debate a little better because he's a hell of a debater. But
oh yeah, it gets frustrating at times.
Yes, I'm not the only one. Woohoo! But yeah, what's interesting is this 11 lines of code. Here's what it does. It's used to add characters to the beginning of a string of text, like a zero to the beginning of a zip code. It's a single-purpose function, simple enough for most programmers to write themselves. Lots of MPM packages, however, relied on left-pad to do it for them, which is how this tiny bit of code became so important.
You've got minimum coding experience. I mean, like you said, how long would you think it would take someone to write that for themselves?
Oh, 11 lines, that little bit?
Yeah.
Well, even someone at my – see, someone like me, probably 30 minutes. Someone like the producer, 2 minutes.
Okay. That's I didn't want to automatically sit there and think, oh, 11 lines, surely that can – because that's the dumbest way of looking at programming ever, and I bet – in fact, I know because I have friends that are programmers that have people that come to them, clients, and say, oh, it's just this amount of – surely you can do that in a couple of minutes, right?
Yeah, and the reason why I say that is because he's well-versed in JavaScript. Even Tyler could probably do it in 4 or 5 minutes. Me, I struggle with JavaScript, but I'm the kind of guy that I got to go look at examples and – I can take that and work with it. But, you know, if you got a fundamental understanding of the language, it wouldn't take long. It's, you could almost call it laziness or the idea of years and years ago, I forget, I think it was called like, you know, code widgets or whatever. It was like, well, we're just going to create all these little widgets of code where you don't have to just reinvent the wheel every time. You just use these widgets of code. And that's essentially what this has come about to is – they just make these calls to these little widgets of code. Is you know, I don't want to write my own little function that puts a character in front of this or a zero or whatever. It's in my library, I'll make a single line call out to that, and then that's all I got to do. Which unfortunately breaks things like Facebook and Twitter and all those other places that actually, because Facebook actually relied on it too, so parts of Facebook were affected.
Yeah.
So I think the takeaway here is the guy was acting a little douchey, though I can kind of see why he was, but it really wasn't the way to do it. He could have simply changed the name. You know, sometimes you don't, you know, taking a stand is great, but that's probably not one of the times to do it. But the bigger point is the fact of the heavy reliance on one little module of code that's only 11 lines long. And when it was gone, people nutted up. What's going on? My stuff's broken. So, okie dokie. Let's see. What do we got here? I honestly did not read this article. I didn't get a chance to get to it. CNBC tried and massively failed to teach people about password security.
Okay, so I put this one in anyway, so I can tell you. Let me give you the basic read through, and we'll be able to. I can scrunch it down to a smaller thing, but I think some of this. Point. Okay, I'll try.
Okay.
Point is that CNBC. made a web page and actually on the article there is a screen capture of this if you want to find that, where they said it was talking about the strongness of passwords, and it was well meaning. It's one of these things to where I will step back and say this was well intentioned, But they were trying to teach people the importance of a longer password with alphanumeric things, randomly peppered, stuff like that. So they created an algorithm that you could put a password into, hit the check button, and it would tell you if it was strong or not. Now, that tone told me that you're seeing where this is headed. Here's how this worked. This whole thing came up from the whole Apple versus FBI thing, which has gotten totally on its own here. And I'm sure we'll talk about it within the next couple of weeks as it goes on, because I still don't think it's fully finished yet. But thanks to endless data breaches, hacks, and the U.S. government's seemingly endless fight against encryption, privacy and security have now effectively become mainstream news topics. That's good. We should all be aware of the fact that everything on the internet is fundamentally broken and how we're vulnerable because of it. But that's also not so good, because now we're getting security advice from a lot of people who have no idea what they're talking about. Take, for example, a post titled, quote, "Apple and the Construction of Secure Passwords" on CNBC's data-driven blog, The Big Crunch. The intention behind it was great. Teach internet users the vital importance of having a strong and unique password. Too bad the execution was just infuriatingly bad. The story had been taken down with no explanation, but you can see an archived version here. And again, I take you to the website where it shows a caption of it. With the court fight between Apple and the FBI as a news peg, CNBC tried to teach people that accounts secured by simple passwords can easily be guessed or brute forced. With a custom-coded tool that analyzed readers' passwords. But the first capital sin of this article was asking users to type in their own passwords in order to check how secure they were over a website that doesn't use HTTPS web encryption, no less.
Wow.
This was first noticed by Google security engineer Adrian Porter Felt, who noticed the whole thing. That means that after a user typed in her password, the password was initially sent to a Google spreadsheet, traveling completely insecurely through the internet. Anyone on the way, say a hacker snooping on the Starbucks Wi-Fi connection you were reading the article on, can now steal it. Did you type your real password? Congratulations, it's now been shared with not just CNBC and that friendly Starbucks hacker, but also with more than 30 third parties, such as advertisers and analytics providers who pull data from CNBC.com, as noted by independent security and privacy research Ashkin Soltani. Also, please stop using one password for everything and start using a password manager.
Yes.
Amen to that. Hackers know that people reuse passwords and will test it against Facebook, Bank of America, and so on. What's more, CNBC's tool to evaluate password strength also seemed to be underestimating how quickly short passwords can be cracked. Quote, "This is a story of exactly what not to do when trying to educate users about password security," Soltani wrote in a tweet. Needless to say, the article has sent InfoSec Twitter's into a tailspin, with people angrily tweeting the CNBC data reporter who worked on the article, as well as others just cracking jokes. CNBC did not immediately respond to a request for comment. At least it got one thing right in the original piece, including this excellent XKCD comic on password strength. So they actually put an XKCD comic in the article, which is a nice touch. Perhaps they should have replaced the whole article with that. Wow. So...
Oh my
so
God.
So the whole thing, yeah, this was a massive failure. A well-intentioned failure, but a failure nonetheless.
Well, it's unfortunate, but that's what happens when you have journalists and bloggers that don't actually know what the hell they're doing on the technical side of it try to do something like this. Now, to be fair, unless I missed it, I don't know exactly who came up with the algorithm. But if there had been one IT person with a single iota of a common sense intellectual brain cell that knew anything about password security, they wouldn't have let this fly. They would have, well, number one, it's not secure. Number two, why are you storing the passwords in a Google spreadsheet? Jeez.
Because I'm pretty sure you could hack up a thing to where it wouldn't even have to store the password anyway,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, you don't. There's absolutely no reason to store that password. I mean, you can create a secure site. You can build the algorithm in JavaScript or whatever. It never actually leaves the freaking page. There's no reason to actually store it anywhere like that. And this is, oh my God, somebody needs to get sued over this.
Yeah.
Wow. I think I figured out the show title. Oh man. Yeah, I didn't realize how bad this, when you had shared it and I didn't get a chance, I just read the headline and I was like, what is this about? Oh man, this is terrible. This is absolutely terrible. Well, you know, it's probably best, the takeaway from that is, number one, don't put your password into a website that's going to tell you how strong it is, unless you are absolutely 100% sure that this thing has been vetted. And,
yeah, I think,
you know,
I think Steve Gibson may have a tool for that over at grc.com if someone wants
yeah,
to.
And he's one you can definitely trust. I mean, this Probably. Is what he does for a living, so. Oh, and number two, use a password manager. LastPass is
yes.
a great one. 1Password is another one. I mean, I have used LastPass for 3 years now. Matter of fact, I pay $12 a year for it, and
same here.
It's fantastic. I don't know any of my passwords. Not a single one of them. I'm like,
the joke I always tell people, because I think I'm maybe one of the few people that actually does use a password manager amongst my friends and stuff, which is surprising, but anyway. I've joked before that if someone were to put a gun to my head and say, get me into your Facebook, I wouldn't be able to do it. I just have to say, shoot me. I don't know what it is.
That's right. That's right. And if I ever lose or if I ever forget the master password to LastPass, I am teetotally screwed.
Because they don't even have the ability to get into it.
Even though I think, well, we may have to revisit this, but the producer and I actually went through and looked. There's a way to get that master password, but there's no guarantee. If because they don't have it, but
right.
So I'm still confident and I feel secure by letting it handle all of my passwords. I'd be lost without it because I was one of those that unfortunately. I used a very strong password, but I used the thing every frickin' where. So if I ever
right.
got compromised, everything was going to get compromised. And that's the reason why I said, look, you know, I'm an IT guy. I'm being a moron here. So I went with LastPass and haven't looked back. So, All right. Well, I guess that's going to wrap it up for this. We got through these articles, and, hey, it's been fantastic. So, Mr. Sam Lewis, where can people find you and all your stuff when you're not here on Friday evenings talking tech?
Totally. You can find all of my stuff, as it were, at tscn.tv, all my podcast and other things like Let's Plays. And if you want to find me more personally, you can find all that social media stuff at about.me/labtech7.
Very good. All right. You can find all the stuff that I'm doing, like this show, TechSlant, over at slant.fm. Let's see, probably the other place is about.me/gdadkissen for all the other social media stuff. If you got any feedback for this episode or any of the other episodes that you've listened to, shoot us an email. The email is feedback@slant.fm, or if you are the verbal type, you can leave us a voicemail, 313-718-2557. So that's going to wrap it up for this episode. This is the April Fool's episode. So everything we've talked about tonight was completely BS. It was not true. No, I'm kidding. These were all valid articles. Yes, they were. All right. Until next week, guys, take care of yourselves. Peace. All right. I'm thinking the title of this episode can be something like, "Dude, have you seen my password?"
I like that.
All right, let's go with that. All right, I'm going to record it. In 3, 2, 1. This is TechSlant, episode 119, recorded on April 1st, 2016. Yes, that's right, April Fools. Dude, have you seen my password? All right.
Love it. Love it.
I'm freaking tired now. Jeez.
We got passionate this episode. It was a good one.
Yeah. I'm trying to think if I got enough in me to do something with Carl and Skip.
You're fine if you don't.
Well, let's just do something. Let's wing it, see what happens. All right, I'm going to start off.
Okay.